how to sequence air traffic. When an airport starts to get busy, usually something needs to be done to manage both inbound and outbound traffic flow. This is called sequencing, and it can be done by four different methods. 1. Applying speed control. 2. Managing departure intervals. 3. Vectoring. And 4. Using holding patterns. The speed control we have covered already. If you missed that episode, go check out the video here. The second method for sequencing traffic is controlling the departures by time. If we go deep down into air traffic flow management with target startup approval times, target off-block times, and calculated takeoff times, this video would be at least like an hour long and honestly quite boring. If you want to know everything about flow management, read the video description below. You'll find all the material you need right there. But here's the basic principle of departure flow control. Managing two things, demand and supply. In aviation terms, this is balancing between the amount of air traffic and the capacity of airspace and airports. Check this out. Every airport has a capacity of traffic that they can handle safely, a value that has been calculated based on the configuration of runways, taxiways, apron capabilities, ATC services, arrival and departure routes, and so on. This value is not constant. When an airport with multiple runways is running normally on a beautiful day, the value is X amount of arrivals or departures in an hour. This number may be decreased due to factors like one of the runways not being operational, nearby thunderstorms, heavy snowfall, or even strong winds. The flow management system starts kicking in when the amount of traffic in an airport exceeds the current capacity value. This can be either at the departure airport or several hours away at the arrival destination, based on different flight plans, with all the aircraft reaching there at the same time. In these cases, all the traffic within this busy period gets assigned a time when they have to take off from their departure aerodrome so that the rush hour gets spread out more evenly and further delays at the destination airport may be avoided. Instead of all the traffic departing freely on their flight plan departure times and meeting at the arrival airport at the same time causing congestion, the slot times are allocated to make the spacing naturally when traffic is flying towards the same destination. Besides the airports, airways can also get congested. ATS routes can end up so busy that there's just enough room in the RVSM airspace for everyone to fly simultaneously. Besides the vertical separation requirements, traffic on the same flight levels must be horizontally spaced, commonly between 5 to 10 nautical miles. Sometimes either a planned or unpredicted event can affect that spacing requirement. The most common ones are weather phenomena like a thunderstorm, or the ATC unit handling the en route airspace switches from using a radar to a procedural control temporarily. In both cases, the spacing requirement increases dramatically. Let's say the spacing would be 7 nautical miles under normal circumstances, when on a given ATS route all traffic starts to avoid heavy thunderstorms in unpredicted directions. The spacing between the consecutive departures needs to be increased to about 20 or 25 nautical miles so controllers can approve the diversion requests from pilots and handle the situation safely. What does this mean for the departing traffic? Well, some delays, of course. And how much delay? Let's calculate. In most cases, a terminal radar controller can increase the gap between two consecutive departures from 3 miles to about 6 to 8 miles with some speed control. If we need, for example, 20 miles in between those departures, the terminal environment is usually too small to play around with speed control alone. We still need about 12 miles extra to have the 20 by the time the aircraft joins the airway. The easiest method to gain this is by the tower controller having minimum departure intervals between these flights. If an aircraft flies at a speed of 240 knots, it will fly 4 miles in 1 minute. When the tower controller launches the departures at 3-minute intervals, there should roughly be enough space in between for the radar controller to get the rest of the job done. And then we move on to the next piece of equipment in our toolbox, vectoring. The art of turning the aircraft away from their planned route to some random headings. Well, maybe not that random. There is reasoning behind every move we make, every step we take, and of course we will be watching you. Here's how we generate some extra distance between two aircraft. It doesn't matter if these aircraft are departing, arriving, or even on cruising levels. The principle is exactly the same. Two flights are following each other to a common point. They are 5 miles apart, and we want them to be 10 miles in our example. We're going to keep the first aircraft flying towards that point, making sure it flies at least at the same speed as the following one, preferably faster. Next, we turn the following aircraft away from its current track about 30 to 45 degrees and attach the radar distance measuring tool from that common point to both aircraft. From now on, the direct distance between these two aircraft is irrelevant. What matters is the two numbers that we get from the measurement line readings. It's like trigonometry, with the angle we use to turn the following aircraft, how much the speed difference between the two aircraft is, and how long we wait. At some point, we will notice that soon, there will be a 10 nautical mile difference between the distance readings. Then we should turn the following aircraft to fly back towards that point. We make sure that the speeds of both aircraft are locked in, and when both of these aircraft cross that point, they will be that required 10 nautical miles apart. There are variations in how this maneuver can be done. Sometimes when the airspace for performing the vectoring is limited, we can do a zigzag move. It works the same as we just did in our first example, but instead of turning the following aircraft only once, we do two or more turns left and right, keeping the following aircraft increasing the distance from the leading aircraft until we have enough gap to turn the following aircraft back towards that common point. This vectoring split can also be done with more than two aircraft with the same moves. Always remember to keep the first one flying fastest towards that common point, and turn the next ones, keeping them slower. For example, the second one is turned 20 degrees and is kept 30 knots slower than the first one. The third one is turned 40 degrees, maintaining a speed 60 knots slower than the very first one. Once desired distances are gained, we turn the aircraft towards the point and lock in the speeds. The last method of sequencing traffic is using holding patterns. If there already are ways like departure flow control, speed control, and vectoring to create some gaps so easily, why do we need the holding patterns? Why do we instruct the aircraft to circle in the air before reaching the destination? The most common reasons are: 1. Departure flow control was not sufficient. Not all parts of the world are covered in a global flow control mechanism. And even if the flow control system was worldwide, it is not a precise science. For example, on a long-haul flight, a 10-minute fluctuation in arrival time is quite normal due to changing wind conditions, speed control, or vectoring along the way. A 10 to 20-minute variation in arrival time can make a huge difference whether to avoid a peak traffic jam or not. 2. Unexpected situations. Sometimes there can be foreign object debris on the runway, an emergency, faulty or unreliable navigation equipment, or pretty much anything that disrupts the normal traffic flow. 3. Weather, the most common one. It can be as simple as a changing wind direction that causes a change of runway in use. Then some buffer is needed between the last arrival to the old runway and the first arrival to the new runway. For obvious reasons, we don't want these two aircraft to be head-on on the opposite finals. Another reason can be a thunderstorm blocking some parts of the terminal airspace, causing the airport capacity to drop momentarily. Then how do we decide to use holding instead of vectoring? It depends on how long we need to delay the arriving aircraft. A normal holding pattern looks something like this. There's the holding fix, outbound leg, inbound leg, and the 180-degree turns on both ends. If this pattern is at 14,000 feet or below, the inbound and outbound legs should be flown at 230 knots for 1 minute each, and the turns should be done at a rate of 3 degrees per second. That means one spin on this merry-go-round takes about 4 minutes. And that gives us the reference for using this pattern. Many airports use some kind of software to calculate the timings for the arriving aircraft when they should enter the terminal airspace boundary via the entry point. This system is programmed with the current capacity value, how many arriving aircraft the airport can handle. It also knows the distances and the speed constraints on those routes. Based on all this information, it will assign all traffic a time frame when they have to fly the point inbound so that there is always the right amount of traffic in the terminal area to meet the capacity value. The sequencing controller is responsible for feeding the traffic inbound for the approach controller, according to the times given by the arrival manager software. If the required delay for a particular aircraft is 4 minutes, the easiest way to create this is by letting the aircraft fly the holding pattern for one round and then issuing an onward clearance to continue the journey. 8 minutes means 2 rounds, 12 minutes 3 rounds, and so on. A 2-minute delay could be done by instructing the aircraft to do a 360 turn on the holding fix, with 3 degrees per second, it would accumulate the required 120 seconds. A 1 minute delay is pretty much impossible to accomplish with a holding pattern. Some vectoring or speed control is needed. Delays of any other odd minute number usually require some mixed application of holding and vectoring, since either a full holding pattern or a 360 turn is too long or too short. One method to accomplish this is by starting with the holding and waiting until the aircraft has overflown the holding fix and made the first 180 turn to fly the outbound leg. Then we will instruct the aircraft to continue on the outbound heading and attach the distance measurement tool between the aircraft and the holding fix. Keeping in mind the aircraft's speed and time needed to turn again towards the point, we instruct the turn precisely for the aircraft to overfly the point and begin the arrival route at the right time. Want to learn more? Join us for more ATC training videos. See you there!